Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to the 17th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2023. We've got apologies this morning from Colin Beattie. The first item on our agenda is to agree or not to take agenda items 3, 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed, thank you. The main item for consideration this morning is the report produced by Audit Scotland into the criminal court's backlog. So can I welcome our witnesses this morning, Auditor General for Scotland, Stephen Boyle, who's joined this morning by Mark Taylor, who's an Audit Director at Audit Scotland, and by Lindsay Davis, who's an Audit Manager at Audit Scotland. As usual, Auditor General, we've got quite a number of questions that we'd like to put to you. But before we do that, can I invite you to make a short opening statement?
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. COVID-19 pandemic created a large backlog of criminal court cases waiting to be heard. Since then, significant progress has been made by the Scottish Government, the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service and their partners in reducing the overall backlog. Throughout the pandemic, partners in the criminal justice system identified innovative solutions to support recovery, including the use of remote jury centres and cinemas. The Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service also made very effective use of data modelling to inform decision-making about the effects of the backlog and to help identify solutions. This included the introduction of the Courts Recovery Programme in September 2021, which helped increase Scotland's criminal court capacity and reduce the backlog. In September 22, the number of outstanding scheduled trials peaked at over 43,500. This is more than double the Courts and Tribunal Service considers as its normal operating capacity level. This figure has reduced month on month since then and stood at just over 28,000 in February of this year. The pandemic backlog of summary cases, such as common assault, domestic abuse and breach of the peace, is reducing. And the Court Service estimates that this is on track to be cleared in March of 2024. However, the backlog of solemn cases, such as serious assault, murder, rape and sexual offences, peaked in January of 2023, but will take until March of 2026 to be cleared. It's important to acknowledge, Convener, the impact of the backlog on victims, witnesses and the accused who are experiencing longer waits for their cases to be heard. Average waiting times for solemn, the more serious cases, have more than doubled since the pandemic and currently stand at between 43 and 53 weeks. Some of these crimes disproportionately impact on women and children. The Scottish Government published its vision for justice in Scotland in February of last year, but the supporting three-year delivery plan for continued recovery and reform of the criminal justice system has been delayed until the summer of this year. It's important that the Scottish Government finalises and publishes this plan as a priority. My report makes recommendations to the Scottish Government, the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, as they work to reduce the backlog and reform the criminal justice system. Convener, Lindsay, myself and Mark look forward to answering your questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. I think that statement sets the scene very well. What I wanted to start off by asking you was, you mentioned at the start of the report that you've got a plan to monitor the recommendations that you've made in the report. So could you tell us a little bit more about how you plan to do that monitoring work?
Yes, of course. I'll say a bit about this report specifically and any further work that we might do on the justice system. And I'll ask Mark to say a wee bit more about some of our wider arrangements, if that would be helpful to the committee. You'll see, Convener, that we make recommendations at page 6 of the report. We think very carefully about the recommendations. Sometimes we make recommendations to individual bodies and other times to wider covering, you know, in this instance, both the Scottish Government and the Courts and Tribunal Service. We undertake a range of mechanisms, which we haven't settled on specifically for this report yet, so given that it's fairly fresh. But what we like to do in recommendations is to set out who they're for and the timescales for that. So in this report, Some of these are quite shorter than you might typically see at the committee for some of our reports, so covering the next 3 to 6 months and then up to 12 to 18 months. We've got mechanisms open to us, such as a follow-up report, reporting through the annual audit of these organisations, or indeed we also have impact reporting mechanisms. We're just finalising our options, but given that some of these are quite short in timescale, convener, we'll settle on that fairly soon over the course of the rest of this year to take stock of the progress that the government and the Courts and Tribunal Service is making. I think it's particularly relevant given that one of our core recommendations is around implementation of the three-year or the publication of the three-year delivery plan, and that's expected in the summer. So we'll be tracking that and reporting publicly on the progress on that front. If you find it helpful, maybe Mark might want to say a bit more about the wider work we're doing about recommendations and impact monitoring.
Thank you, Auditor General, and happy to do so. You'll recall when we came to speak to you recently about the Auditor General's work programme, we touched a wee bit on our impact and insights work, and it's building on the work that we've always done to follow through on the recommendations that we've made. But I guess to give a bit more visibility around that, do that a bit more systematically, both in terms of follow through of recommendations, but also what does that tell us across the piece and pulling more of that out. Amongst that work, we'll be piloting a number of approaches, and one of the things that we'll publish shortly is a report around city and region deals and looking back at our recent joint report between the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission at the impact that that's had. And it will be an opportunity, I think, for the committee to see some of that in practice in a wee bit more. I think the trick here is to get the balance right between the work programme being dominated by looking back at all the work that's already been done and making sure that we're balancing that with getting into new areas.
Thank you. I mean, obviously, we see a lot of your reports, and I thought it was interesting that in this one, your recommendations are aligned with timetables. So you've got things that you expect to happen in 3 to 6 months, things over the next 12 months, and then over the next 12 to 18 months. Which I think is a very useful way of addressing some of the challenges that you've identified. It seems to me to be quite innovative and very, very useful indeed. Are those timescales ones that you have agreed with the Scottish Government and with the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service?
Yeah, I'll maybe ask Lindsay to say a bit more about the clearance arrangements. So, you know, I think all of our reports are shared with the relevant bodies, and we write to the Director General of the Scottish Government for all of our performance audit reports to give opportunity for fact-checking and comment, and that's part of our standard arrangements. Grateful for your feedback, firstly, Convener. Actually, I think in making a recommendation, you know, all of us would expect that it follows that SMART principle, and particularly, you know, having clear timescales, I think, gives an opportunity for the public body to consider the recommendation, what's reasonable and realistic, and then also that you can have that follow through so that it's clear what was asked for and what was delivered. I think all of our recommendations in today's report can be seen in the context of what's achievable. From a public audit perspective, there's not a great deal of merit in us making a recommendation, clear or appropriate we think, if actually there's that sense of it's just not achievable from the public body. So aligning the recommendation, the timescale, is what we've tried to do in today's report. But Lindsay can say a wee bit more about the engagement we've had with the courts and the government on this.
Yeah, thanks very much, Auditor General. So we shared the draft report with the Scottish Government and Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service at the clearance stage, and that included the time-bound recommendations. There were no comments received back or issues identified with them.
Thanks. That's really very helpful. Quite a lot of the report addresses the response during the pandemic and the lockdown and all the restrictions that were in place at that time. And Willie Coffey's got a series of questions on that. But before I turn to Willie, I've just got one, which is that one of the things that happened was that the sheriff court system was consolidated into, I think, kind of 10 hub centres. I think the JP courts were incorporated into that as well. So we had 10 hubs, and they were asked, I think, to consider essential business. Could you tell us how they defined essential business?
You're right, Convener. Actually, we set out in the report, I think they moved from 39 to 10 hubs from across the various sheriffdoms across Scotland. In terms of the prioritisation, I guess there's a number of steps, and Lindsay can set this out in a bit more detail for the committee. If I may say a word or two before that, I think what we've seen in the report is that the system in the early stages of the pandemic came together to, you know, through a range of governance and prioritisation mechanisms that looked at how they could continue to deliver the courts and justice system at the height of the pandemic. It's not that long ago, but I suppose memories can fade over the course of the past year and a bit when we come out of lockdown. But we recall that, you know, these were two national lockdowns, prolonged social distancing, and, you know, a sense of this could bring severe pressure, not just in the court system, because Scotland's justice system is interconnected, and what that might mean for the number of people held on remand, the waits for cases to be heard, and the associated human cost that that has on people who are experiencing the justice system. So we saw that one of those innovations was actually how to get that throughput continuing and bringing down into a hub model. Perhaps say a bit more over the course of this morning about some of the other innovations that supported that. But in terms of the prioritisation, Lindsay can set that out.
Yeah, in terms of the prioritisation, priority was given to the custody trials, because in legislation the accused are supposed to be heard by the court on the next lawful day. So the hub courts were prioritising that sort of business around about the initial stages of the lockdown.
OK, thank you. I am going to turn now to Willie Coffey, who has got some more questions in this whole COVID response area.
Thanks very much. Thanks very much, Convener. Stephen, I wonder if you could tell us a little bit more about the initial responses that happened as a result of COVID, particularly the digital electronic transformation of documents side of things that you say in the report what was a successful thing to do. So could you tell us a wee bit more about how that worked, and also, is it still in place post COVID in the period that we're in?
Yeah, morning, Mr. Coffey. Can I say, Lindsay, actually, I think probably best place to sit, I suppose, some of the digital and the evidence sharing arrangements that were one of the innovations that we refer to in the report. And I'm sure she'll want to say a bit more about some of the use of data. I know this is a theme that this committee considers regularly in terms of how well data is being used across public bodies and the delivery of public services. I think today's report is a welcome change of tone, actually. I think what we've seen through our audit work and set out by the Courts and Tribunal Services, that data was used effectively. They had deployed data modelling to support the delivery of the court service and the prioritisation. They used scenario planning to set out what would happen if there weren't some of the innovations that are set out in the report. And then also have reported that transparently as well in terms of the use of data. All of that has built on into some of the specific examples that we cover in the report. And Lindsay can talk the committee through that, Mr. Coffey.
Yeah, so in terms of some of the digital solutions that were implemented, there was the installation of video conferencing facilities within police custody suites to allow the accused to appear remotely. That was initially done to prevent the transport of the accused who were presenting with COVID-19 symptoms, but then it was used more widely, even where symptoms weren't present. Also, in terms of the conduction of criminal court business by electronic means, that also allowed for the establishment of the virtual summary trial pilots as well to take place, where the victims and witnesses were able to give their evidence remotely out with the courtroom. And that provision also allowed for the remote jury centres to be established, whereby the juries were remote from the courtroom.
Maybe just one point I would add as well to that, but one of the barriers to effective working across partners and use of data is data sharing arrangements not being in place. We refer at paragraph 34 of the report as part of the Recover, Renew and Transform programme, really one of the overarching arrangements that kind of set out how services would be delivered in the criminal court system, was that was part of their thinking. So the committee will again be familiar of many examples where data sharing arrangements haven't been in place between public bodies, but we've seen that that was the case supported by the Scottish Government's Justice and Analytical Services Division, and that continues to be the case as they look to further reduce the backlog and as part of their thinking around transformation, Mr. Coffey.
Thank you for that. I was speaking with the Procurator Fiscal in Kilmarnock last week to discuss this report, and she was talking about the presentation of digital evidence that has led to early presentation and disclosure of evidence that seemed to turn the backlog around pretty quickly. And it's always been possible to do that, Convener, but COVID made us do things that we had not possibly considered before. And that seems to have been a particularly successful thing to do. And I wonder if that process is still going to continue to be embedded at the heart of this system to further reduce the backlog.
Yeah, happy to come in on that. That in terms of the Coronavirus Act, the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Act 2022 was brought in last year. I can double check to see if those provisions are still in place. One project that we mentioned within the report is the DESC project, which is the Digital Evidence Sharing Capability Project, and that was something that was being worked on pre-COVID, but the government announced that this year that it's been piloted within Dundee and with a view to further nationwide rollout later this year. And that essentially is creating a unified digital system for evidence sharing between the court staff, prosecutors, defence agents and police, where they can handle and access the evidence as well. And that's that's an important part of the summary case management pilot that's ongoing, which relies on disclosure of evidence to the accused and their defence agent as well, so that they're more informed of the case against them. I think in domestic abuse cases that evidence disclosure is automatic, so the DESC system will help with the timely provision of that evidence.
Yes, she certainly mentioned that, but I just wonder, is that system available to us in the solemn cases? Because I know you said that the backlog is still pretty high, so is that process usable in solemn cases?
I would need to double-check the information on that and get back to you on that, if that's okay. All right.
Thanks very much. Stephen, your report also tells us that the pace that was required for the emergency response for COVID, it did highlight good collaboration amongst all the partners in the initial stages of the pandemic. So what's your evidence base for the conclusions that you've reached? Because you also note that there was a failure to fully document plans and outcomes and so on and so forth. So how are you able to reach a conclusion if you don't have a documentary evidence base to to look back on?
Yeah, happy to come in. I think there's both things are true in today's report. So, you know, we all recall the early stages of the pandemic and, you know, public services trying to sustain services. So we touched on this morning already to a degree that the court service, primarily because of its earlier investment pre-pandemic, it had invested in data, it upskilled in data in a way that some other public services hadn't. So it was it was able to use that expertise to deliver and sustain services, model scenarios, working with its partners to really look at the scenario, Mr. Coffey, of if they didn't do this, if they didn't, you know, explore some of the innovations that in terms of remote jury centres, remote balloting, some of the evidence sharing arrangements that Lindsay mentions, what that would meant was potentially an overwhelming of the system, many, many years to hear cases and all the human cost that brings. It's also true that decisions were taken at pace at the start of the pandemic. And I think, as we also set out in earlier reports on COVID, that is to be expected. But what we don't do in today's report is give a clean bill of health entirely around some of the decision-making and the governance arrangements. I think as we look forward and touch on some of the latter stages of the pandemic, that not all of the governance was as effective as it should have been. The role that some critical parts of the governance system played weren't as comprehensive And we've particularly mentioned advisory groups, which tend to be comprised of representative groups, victim support arrangements. The use and application of equality impact assessments still has some way to go. So applying all of these things into a rounded, effective governance model for some of the vital transformation arrangements that are still planned has still got some work to do. But that doesn't detract from what we say that the start of the report is that at real pace and a time of crisis, the Courts and Tribunal Service and their partners worked well to sustain and give allow the system to continue functioning.
OK. Thank you. Mark?
Yeah, just very, very briefly, to the root of your question, Mr. Coffey, I think often, and this is a bit of a generalisation, often in the audit business, we are reliant on evidence of work in progress and governance and those things. And as the Auditor General says, that's really important. In this circumstance, the speed of the response is such that we're able to look at the actions that were achieved, which have involved multiple partners, and the implementation of those actions. I think really strong evidence from us about the way in which for that to occur was that collaboration taking place.
OK, thank you. Last question from me, convener, if I may. I mean, the backlog clearly has an impact on victims and witnesses. We know that, and you've said that quite clearly in your report. Is there any other additional support you think is required by the Scottish Government other than providing some additional funding to assist it? Is there any other type of support you consider, whether it be advocacy or whatever else, to assist victims and witnesses to get through this process?
Yeah, I think a couple of things to say, and then I'll maybe limit my response actually to an extent. I mentioned that the use of the advisory groups for some of the reform was a necessary and welcome part of the consideration of how services would be delivered over the course of the pandemic and the future, but they weren't fully deployed. So really, you know, you've got Victim Support Scotland, Rape Crisis Scotland, and other groups who represent people's experiences of the justice system weren't used to the extent that we might have expected and would expect as part of these transformations. And I mentioned how that was applied into the equality impact assessment. And especially, as I mentioned in some opening remarks, is that women and children are disproportionately affected by some of the crimes that are related to the backlog. In terms of, you know, their place in shaping the system and consultation with stakeholders, that's a vital component, so that there is a shared understanding, shared view, and effective consultation, Mr. Coffey, for how services should be delivered. So you're right, funding is also one mechanism, but having the voice of users as part of shaping the system matters too. Ultimately, it'll be up to the government and the court service for how they make best use of and engage with people who have a stake in the justice system.
Thank you very much for that for the moment. Thank you, convener. Hope to come back in later on.
Thank you. Yeah, I will bring you back in later on. But next I'm going to call on Craig Hoy to put some questions to you. Craig.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Mr. Ball. Obviously, prison overcrowding is nothing new, and you've previously reported that the prisoner population in Scotland today exceeds the capacity of the Scottish prison estate. To what extent can you say that the court's backlog, and particularly the number of prisoners being held on remand, sometimes for extended periods, to what extent can you say this is impacting upon the existing and long-standing pressures within the Scottish Prison Service?
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Hoyle. I guess a couple of points I would reference, just to bring to the committee's attention the points that you make, that prisoners held on remand increased by 14%. Over the course of the pandemic. Time spent on remand, which is, you know, a linked statistic, also increased. And we also, just to highlight to the committee's attention at paragraph 79, some of the equalities considerations of remand further, where, according to prison population statistics in 2021, the proportion of women on remand was 30%, young people 48%, compared to 25% of men. We haven't looked into the detail, the background between these statistics, but they're a very relevant factor that the Courts and Tribunal Service and the government will want to consider. And if I may, just to set my answer a bit further, we produced a report last year on the workings of community justice in Scotland, that also reported that Scotland has one of the highest prison populations per head of population in Western Europe. All of these factors lead to, what does that mean for the justice system that Scotland wants to have post-COVID, some of the reforms that are intended? And we're also thinking about, you know, what that means for our own work programme in terms of the prison estate, the pressures that are under on the Scottish Prison Service and so forth. So all of that is in our thoughts, Mr Hoy, for future audit work.
And do you know what, if any, assessment is being made into the extent to which the figures and the high figures and increasing figures of the number of people being held on remand is impacting those individuals, for example, in relation to their mental health or the loss of earnings or the loss of their employment or any impact it might have in relation to their future housing arrangements?
Yeah, those are the factors that we also identified in our community justice briefing paper as well, about the impact of prison sentencing being held on remand and that what that means for the life chances of those people. All those are relevant. In terms of what work has been done around that, clearly a vital role that's you know, part of any work for the government, the court service, the community justice authorities as well, that they are playing a connected role with the multi-agency partners who will you know, support people who have experience of the justice system. It wasn't part of our scope for this audit, I should say, but it's something that you know, we retain an active interest in.
Paragraph 29 on page 17 of the report states that the Scottish Government introduced the maximum time that an accused person can be held on remand prior to a trial without the court granting an extension through the Coronavirus Scotland Act No. 2. Could you tell the committee a bit more about those time limit extensions that the Scottish Government has introduced, as well as what they were previously prior to COVID, particularly in relation to those being held on remand?
I'll ask Lindsay to set that out for the committee. We have a bit of detail. What we set in the paragraph is really the time limits before COVID, what the Coronavirus Act meant, and really the implications had that not been in place, and the anticipation of, we don't use this expression in the report, but really rubbing up against the effective functioning of the justice system had some of those provisions not been considered. But Lindsay can talk to that.
Yeah, so as we say in the report, they were introduced as without them, applications would need to be made to the court on a case-by-case basis to extend those time limits, and that would have taken a significant amount of court time to do. But there is some mixed feedback in terms of their effectiveness. So I think there's agreement that at the beginning they were necessary, but I think obviously as time's going on, they seem to be now having a negative impact. In terms of what the exact time limits were, I can get back to you on that information. But yeah, the Coronavirus Act did extend them, and the time limits are still in place through the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Act 2022, and those temporary provisions are due to expire in November this year, but there is the potential that they could be increased by up to 2 years to November 2025.
Yeah. Mr. Ball, if my memory serves me correctly, you said that for less serious crimes, the backlog should be cleared by spring of next year, but for more serious crimes, it's likely to be 2026. Does that point to a structural imbalance in terms of court provision, for example, at the High Court versus lesser courts?
That's not a judgment we've reached in today's report, Mr. Hoy. I guess a number of factors that maybe, and Mark might want to say a bit more about this as well, is the progress in reducing the backlog for less serious cases was you know, significant. So and that allows us to reach a judgment in the report that in overall terms, that was allowed the backlog to fall. To the extent that one of the responses to it was the intention of the Courts and Tribunal Service and the Scottish Government to shift resource to tackle the solemn case backlog, that's not as straightforward, I should say, because there are, you know, clearly these are different style of cases that require, you know, more input from legal profession, collation of evidence, and so forth. And there are different views about how achievable that is. You know, the report, you know, some of the key stakeholders in terms of criminal lawyers, the Law Society, have also expressed views just how achievable it is to shift resource from summary cases to solemn cases. The imbalance you talk about isn't something we've considered in detail. What we looked at in today's report is how the government managed the backlog. So it is going to take until 24 to reduce the backlog to the normal operating capacity level of around 20,000 cases that the Courts and Tribunal Service anticipates for the less serious cases in 24. And then there's something of a split in the solemn cases. So High Court case backlog by 25, and then totality for the solemn cases, including sheriff cases, by 2026. Much of that will come in about the transformation innovations that the government is thinking. And Mark can maybe touch on some of that if he wishes.
Thank you, Auditor General. Just to pick up on the number of cases in each part of the system. So the vast majority of cases, of course, are summary cases. And in terms of the logistics of running courts, a case is a case to a certain extent. They last for different degrees of time. And the focus on summary initially allowed that overall volume of cases to be brought down. Of course, the consequence of that and an increasing case numbers and the additional complexity of the solemn cases, as we set out in Exhibit 6, those numbers have continued to grow and only very recently have begun, we all hope, and the evidence supports, have turned a corner and dropped back down from there. As the Auditor General says, something that the Court Service was very aware of in its modelling and has taken action to try to address by redirecting resource and as part of its overall plans to try and bring those numbers down. I think more generally the wider vision for justice and the ambitions that are set out for there, one of the things of course we say in the report is a need to translate that to specific plans, and specific plans will need to also address this sort of issue as to how do those specific plans for the wider range of ambitions for the justice system translate to some of the issues that are continuing to be faced. And that's why we say in the report it's really important that the government sets out those specific plans as soon as it's able to do so.
And I'm going to use very much layman terms here. I'm sure appropriate fiscals will be aghast at it, but is there any sense that property fiscals are going soft on those less serious crimes and they're just simply not going to court? There's a bit of jiggery-pokery and deal-making being done in order to bring those numbers down in a quicker fashion than might otherwise have been the case before COVID.
So I'll be really careful. We haven't seen any evidence of that. But importantly, that wasn't really a factor or a part of the scope of our audit work, which was really looking at how the Courts and Tribunal Service and the government worked to manage the implications of COVID-19 on the court service, the criminal court service in Scotland. I think as Lindsay mentioned a few minutes ago, there have been some innovations in that, particularly the remote and digital evidence sharing that has allowed both sides of a criminal case to see the facts more quickly than they would have done beforehand. So it's also, I think, reasonable to say that some of these innovations, whilst triggered by the pandemic, the foundations were in place beforehand, and some of the factors as to why cases are growing in volume are also relevant before the pandemic. So some of there was a growth in solemn cases before the pandemic as well. So whilst the pandemic is the key driver and catalyst for most of it, there were legacy issues prior to that. But in terms of the question you asked, Mr. Hoy, no, we've not seen any evidence of that.
No evidence of jiggery-pokery. Glad to hear it. Right, I'm going to bring in the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie, who's got some questions. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning. The report states that the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service was well-placed to lead the early modelling work that informed decision-making on tackling the criminal court backlog, as it had access to large amounts of data and had the appropriate skills and expertise in-house. Can you tell us more about the in-house skills and expertise and how they were used?
Yeah, good morning, Deputy Convener. You're right, we set that out at paragraph 37 of today's report. And it is a key feature, really, that the Courts and Tribunal Service use data well. And I don't wish to kind of overstate the point, but I think this is a welcome departure from some of the reporting that we've done in previous years. I know it's, and again, been a keen interest to this committee and your predecessor committee about how well public bodies are using data to support, fundamentally, to support decision-making, not in and of itself, And at a time of crisis, that investment and expertise allowed the Courts and Tribunal Service and their partners to use that modelling to forecast what the service would look like without intervention, and also to plan how they would sustain the provision of court service at the earlier stages of the pandemic. In terms of the skills, I'm going to turn to Lindsay just to maybe set out some of the history, if she can, for how the court service was better able to deliver services compared to some other public bodies.
Thank you very much, Auditor General. So ahead of the pandemic, the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service were already collecting large amounts of data on things like the numbers of cases that were coming to court, how many proceeded to an evidence-led trial, and how long these cases were taken. This allowed SCTS to use their analytical team in-house to plug this into modelling to develop that. And as the Auditor General said, in terms of looking at what might happen to the backlog if no action was taken, and also show the impact of particular interventions on the backlog. They also did work with other criminal justice partners, which we mentioned in the report. So the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, there was close liaison as well, just to help inform the modelling in terms of number of cases coming through as well. So it's been a collaborative effort, but SCTS were well placed from the get-go, really.
Thank you. The modelling initially suggested back in 2021 that the target the court service were aiming for to return to normal would be a backlog of 390 High Court trials and 500 Sheriff Solemn trials. The report you've published now said the targets have shifted to 567 High Court trials and 1,892 Sheriff Solemn trials, which is quite a change in the goalpost. Do you know why the court service has done that?
Yes, I think there's a couple of factors. Again, Lindsay can say a bit more about this. One is that the volume of more serious cases was increasing before the pandemic. I should say, Deputy Convener, that this wasn't a sole focus of our audit today, but the kind of the what is considered to be the backlog of cases. Our overall judgment is that the backlog was reduced to around what it was before the pandemic, but there were some trends prior to the pandemic for why some cases were taking longer and an increasing volume of solemn cases as well. We refer paragraph 78 to a couple of those factors, which talks about just the availability of forensic reports, witness availability, parties appearing at court, and some of the adjournment factors that are also a feature of really just the functioning of the court system. What we haven't done is to do an analysis of the specifics of how all of those factors interact with what that means for what's seen as the normal operating capacity of the court service. It's something that perhaps really the Courts and Tribunal Service would be better placed to kind of set that out for the rationale for what's a manageable operating capacity for the court service post-COVID.
Okay, thank you. The report highlights the use of data and early modelling work carried out by the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. Is this modelling work still being used to inform decision-making as work continues to try and address the backlog?
Very short answer, yes, that's our understanding. This is going to be a sustained feature of how the Courts and Tribunal Service will manage its operations.
Okay, thank you. Do you know if any modelling work has been undertaken to help establish what the backlog is likely to be if no funding is put in place to support this?
I'm not sure we do. I may turn to Lindsay in a second to explore if there's been any further scenario plan. But it's a very important point, Deputy Convener, that so there's an assumption that £40 million will be used over the course of the current year's budget, convener, of 23-24 to continue to make inroads into the backlog. But as we've touched on already this morning, that it's not going to be until 26 until the full backlog is finished. Like many public bodies, the Courts and Tribunal Service receives an annual budget. So they'll do medium-term financial planning, and it's their assumption that they'll continue to be funded to deliver their recovery programme and to work on the innovations that they have set out on the Vision for Justice. But we also know that there's a really tight fiscal position and there will be difficult choices that the Scottish Government will have to make as it sets out its budget for next year in 24-25. The Deputy First Minister, in presenting the medium-term financial strategy to Parliament in the past couple of weeks, set out that there is a challenging fiscal position and that will require prioritisation and choices for the Parliament towards the end of this year as it considers its budget. But the assumption remains that funding will continue to be available to support the delivery of the COVID recovery backlog for criminal court cases. Lindsay, if she knows, can say what, if there's been any modelling done, if the funding is or isn't available.
Yeah, I believe the modelling reports to date have shown the impact on the backlog if no action was taken. The most recent modelling report that was developed was from September 2022, and it showed what the impact would be of switching the resources that were the additional resources that were in place for the summary courts towards the solemn courts, and funding as in place for that for 2023-2024, and that switch was made in April this year.
So do you think there is actually enough funding? Just last year it was reported that the court service were told justice is no longer a priority by the government ahead of the budget. So do we know if the court service has been told something similar in subsequent years? And do you think the current settlement represents the service being a priority?
So ultimately, it's for the government to determine its priorities. And I think it's also fair that not everything, you know, can be a priority. How that translates into individual funding allocations for different public bodies or public services will be a matter for the government to set out to Parliament as it considers its budget later this year for 24-25. Ultimately, it's not just about the continuation of the delivery of services as they are currently being delivered. Some of the innovations that are also planned need to be clear in terms of what outcomes are going to be delivered. Are they going to produce efficiencies and so forth? And I think as we set out really towards the end of the report is that all of the innovations that are planned also have to have that mapped through to what additional outcomes are intended from that, what efficiencies are going to be delivered from these. So it's both those factors, Deputy Convener, we would say, is that, you know, it's the funding as it is currently, but also services don't remain the same. So building on some of the modelling and better use of data, does that produce efficiencies as well? But whether what that means for provision of service next year and the year after, the assumption, as we understand it from the Courts and Tribunal Services, that they'll continue to be funded on the current basis, and that allows them to project that they'll clear the backlog completely by March 26.
Okay.
OK, thanks. I'm going to bring Willie Coffey back in now because he's got some more questions about some of these innovations that were developed during the course of the pandemic. Willie.
Thanks again, Convener. Stephen, the remote jury centre model that you've referred to in the report, there was an initial pilot and it was extended, of course, and the whole that pilot cost £12 million to service that. Our usual question from our audit committee about value for money around that particular initiative. Have you been able to assess the value for money element of that?
So, I guess on that narrow point, or something, not something we've considered in isolation, Mr. Coffey, in terms of the delivery of value for money from the remote jury centre. What we have reached is a wider judgment that some of those innovations allowed the Courts and Tribunal Service Scotland's justice system to continue functioning effectively over the course of the pandemic. And we also think it's fair to say that that was a welcome innovation, you know, built on some of the foundations that we've touched on already today, the use of data, prioritising, you know, the cinemas because of their physical space capacity to support social distancing, and also some of the data security factors that were relevant in cinemas. So that, as part of the wider investment of £100 million over the course of the pandemic, allowed the function to perform well and significantly reduce the backlog. But we haven't made that narrow value for money judgment on the use of cinemas.
Mm. mean, the cinemas were perfectly, the cinemas and theatres were perfectly set up for this purpose. Do you envisage cases in the future appearing at a cinema near you? Or is that experiment done and dusted and that's it?
Lindsay can set that out any further insight, but the use of the remote jury centres in cinemas has now ended. So we've seen that as a necessary component of the provision of justice while there was restrictions in terms of people being in confined spaces over the course of the pandemic. If we've got any further insight, Lindsay can offer. If not, we can come back to you in writing.
Okay.
Yeah, so the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service started to decommission the remote jury centres in the summer of last year. I believe two are being retained for the next couple of years just to help in terms of reducing the backlog. They were seen as a kind of temporary recovery measure, if you like. But the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service has obviously said that's a model that's ready developed should there be a need for social distancing again, or perhaps in trials where there's a risk of jury intimidation in the future, where it would be beneficial to keep the jury remote from the courtroom. There is the potential to use them again, but there aren't current plans.
OK, thanks for that. The issue about remote balloting of jurors also seems to have been very welcomed by everyone that participated in that, and that I think is made permanent now, that facility is permanent. Is there anything else as a result of the pandemic, what was done, that you might suggest could also be made permanent?
Yeah, you're right about that, Mr. Coffey, in terms of remote balloting. That's also now a permanent feature in terms of bringing in further efficiencies. I think those are the two examples that we'd say are the most uncontested in terms of some of the innovations that were brought in over the course of the pandemic. Our report also refers to the use of virtual trials, and highlights some pilot exercises that took place in the northeast for domestic abuse cases. But there's more mixed feedback on those. There was some reservations from the legal profession about the appropriateness of entirely virtual trials, the amount of preparation time required for solicitors, and other views expressed about, just about the how well justice is served in an entirely remote environment. So those pilots were relatively small scale in terms of entirely virtual trials as part of the suite of innovations that the court service intended to bring in at the start of the pandemic. And I think that feeds into some of the wider considerations about justice reforms and where next. Some of the reforms, there are a range of views about how appropriate these are, how effective they'll be, what efficiencies they'll bring, and how that may, in some views, rub up against the effective delivery of justice. These are the types of factors that the court service and the government will really need to consider and consult widely before taking forward those next steps.
Okay, thank you for that. And you also talked a few times about up to 20,000 outstanding scheduled trials. It seems quite a high number, but you've explained that there's a norm around that volume and level that I certainly wasn't aware of. Is there any consideration being given to keeping the 10 hubs going to try and reduce that faster, quicker, or will we revert back to the 39 sheriffdom locations that you also mentioned earlier in your report?
I'll ask Lindsay to pick that up if we've got any further insight.
Yes, I don't really have much more to say on that. The 39 sheriff courts are still in operation. They reopened in June 2020. And in terms of the potential future for hub courts, we don't have that information to hand, unfortunately.
OK, that's something hopefully we can come back to, convener. And just the last query from me was about the impact of adjournments, that's a part and parcel of the justice system. We all know that, but was there any particularly significant impacts due to COVID that meant frequent or more prolonged adjournments taking place, and how did we resolve that?
Yes, it's not something we considered in detail as part of our audit, Mr. Coffey, but the impact of it we do refer to, both, I suppose, from a mentioned to the deputy convener a moment or two ago, as one of the factors about why cases are growing and some of the rebasing of post-COVID capacity levels. more directly, it's got a very significant human impact of adjournments, and I think we touched on some of the experiences of people's interaction with the justice system, that the repeated trauma that can be caused from an adjournment as witnesses, accused, victims prepare to give evidence and then are stepped down because of an adjournment to then, you know, be brought back into that scenario. So there's a it's a factor, I'm sure, that, you know, as part of the government and court service and stakeholders' consideration of reforms, why adjournments happen and if there's anything that they wish to consider as part of those innovations. But from our work, it wasn't a detailed focus for us this time. But
do you think others are going to look at that specific issue about whether that created a negative impact? Is that going to be examined by the system, do you think?
If anything further we can add?
Probably not much else that we can say on it. Within the report, we do recognise that the pandemic increased the number of adjournments and delays, which has obviously increased the feelings of uncertainty of victims and witnesses. But in terms of further work that's planned, looking at adjournments by partners, we're probably not in a position to say.
Okay. Thanks very much for your responses to those questions. Convener, back to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. One of the issues which you've already alluded to this morning, which I think certainly jumped out at me in the report, was what you describe as a failure to consistently apply equality impact assessments. And you talk about, and you've mentioned already, the Recover, Renew, Transform advisory group, which I think you said included organisations like Rape Crisis Scotland, Victim Support Scotland and so on. Why, first of all, why were they not involved in equality impact assessment work? And was there simply no equality impact assessment work carried out at all?
I think I can answer that up to a point, Convener, but it's probably a feature of question that maybe better directed at the court service and the Scottish Government. Why it didn't feature prominently? What we've reported is that it didn't feature in the engagement that we had with Victim Support Scotland and Rape Crisis Scotland really points that out. We also draw attention to the fact that some of the crimes that are considered most regularly, the most serious of crimes, disproportionately affect women and children and other minority groups, and therefore we would have expected that equality impact assessments would have featured more prominently, really as they're expected to do so, as part of significant policy implementation and policy development. We make recommendations and conclusions to that effect that that needs to feature much more prominently as the vision for justice and the publication of the three-year delivery plan comes into place.
Yeah, I mean, we spoke earlier on about the prioritisation of cases, and when it went from 39 courts to 10, there had to be some kind of prioritisation exercised. I mean, was there no equality impact assessment, or was there no equality sieve to the prioritisation work at that point?
I can just find my paragraph reference for a second, Convener. Yeah, I think we've noted in the report, Convener, that both for the kind of overall justice system, to deliver some of the court service arrangements, there was a criminal justice board set up that drew on partners from across the justice system, but still didn't have the full consideration of equalities issues that we would expect. So both the prioritisation and also the future innovations, it didn't feature as prominently. And then there's some mitigation for that at the earlier stages of the pandemic, when, you know, there was an inherent focus on pace and delivering and sustaining a service. But in terms of, as we move forward, that it didn't feature as prominently as it needed to is something that we make a judgment on that it really needed to, and some surprise at that.
Okay, thank you. I mean, and so do you get a sense that that is now factored in and is going to become much more of a feature of the work that's been carried out?
So I think ultimately that's our sense, but really what we want to see is evidence to that effect, you know, through both the delivery of the delivery plan and future arrangements that the government and its partners and the court service will take forward.
You mentioned other weaknesses in the report as well, over and above the failure to carry out equality impact assessments. And if I look at paragraph 83, you set those out. And again, they do stand out in the report as being areas of, I think, quite significant concern. So you say the Scottish Government and the Criminal Justice Board did not agree clear plans, outcomes and success measures for the Recover, Renew, Transform programme. You say that the RRT advisory group was not given the opportunity to sufficiently engage in that programme, and the advisory group didn't seem to get full access to decision-making. You say wider public reporting of the programme was limited, that there was inconsistency, minutes of Criminal Justice Board meetings were not produced. I mean, these are some fairly big, there was a lessons learned exercise which doesn't appear to have been adopted. I mean, these are some fairly rudimentary elements of operation that we would expect to be met. And from the report that you've produced and the findings that you've got, they simply weren't. Could you elaborate a bit more on why that is?
So you're right, these are fundamentals of good governance that we would set out in any project, and especially one of transformation, and given the importance that the justice system can have on people's lives. We reached a judgment, convener, these are weaknesses in the delivery of the Recover, Renew and Transformation programme. And I think we spoke earlier this morning that whilst the project was moving at pace in the early stage, and you know, you would allow for some mitigations, as we moved into delivering services over the course of the latter stages of the pandemic, that there were still gaps in governance to support decision making, to map through to outcomes, the effective recording of decisions, minute taking, and really importantly, the vital role that an advisory group plays that it wasn't sufficiently engaged with, and then lessons learned exercises weren't applied, has led us to the judgment that, you know, these are weaknesses that need to be addressed so that the public and stakeholders can have confidence both in the delivery of the justice system, but most importantly, given the context of some of the innovations that are planned, that it's supported by good, clear, transparent decision making.
So has work now begun on addressing these weaknesses?
So that's the understanding that, you know, there is a recognition from the court service and their partners that this is accurate comment. It is for the court service and their partners now to satisfy themselves that effective governance is in place and weaknesses have been addressed. And we expect to see that, and you know, as they publish their three-year delivery plan and take forward future decision-making. As we spoke at the start of today's meeting, that's something that we'll follow up on.
Yeah, thank you. And we might follow up as well in considering what our next steps are going to be. We've got a final series of questions which Craig Hoy wants to put to you. So, Craig, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Mr. Ball, the report states that the three-year delivery plan is, and I quote, critical for ensuring that work continues to modernise the criminal justice system and that it both meets and reflects the needs of people in Scotland, such as women and children, which is something you alluded to earlier, given that the system does appear presently to disproportionately negatively impact women and children. The plan was due to be published in August 2022. Can you say why it wasn't published then? And as you alluded to in your opening remarks, what's the revised timetable for its release and implementation?
I'm not sure we have terribly much more detail, Mr. Hoy, as to the reason for the delay in the publication of the delivery plan that underpins the vision for justice. We know that, you know, there will be factors in terms of capacity, you know, alongside consideration of some of the wider justice reform, some of the bills that have been published to which will be relevant. But it would really be for the Courts and Tribunal Service to set out why there has been a delay. And on top of that, also the need for this to be, you know, transparent, monitored up, that it's mapped to outcomes as part of the publication of the delivery plan. We checked before today's session whether there's any further detail, but as far as we understand, it's still summer of this year that the delivery plan is due to be published.
Obviously, if the delivery plan is still a work in progress, it's probably fair to assume that the proposals within it haven't yet been fully costed and that process may be ongoing. Given that there's £40 million in this financial year allocated to recovery, renewal and transformation of the criminal justice system, to what extent should we have reservations that this money might not be allocated or spent in the most effective or appropriate way?
I think we would always want to be assured that public money is being spent effectively, and myself, Audit Scotland and this committee have a key role as part of that assurance arrangements. What you want to see in terms of a delivery plan, as you rightly refer to, is that it doesn't just set out ambition, but it maps also what's going to be spent and what the outcomes are going to be achieved from that and any associated financial implications. Sometimes we've seen that, and many times we haven't seen that. So there has to be that consistency of publication, really, so that users of the Justice Service can have their expectations met about what it means for them, both for all the stages of the justice system. So until we see the publication of the delivery plan, we'll reserve judgment about how effective it looks.
OK, fine. Paragraph 91 of the report states that advisory group arrangements for the transformational projects supporting Vision for Justice in Scotland are still being discussed. And the report goes on to emphasise the importance of ensuring that the views of a wider group of stakeholders continue to inform decision-making and ensure that equalities issues are fully considered throughout that process. Can you provide any narrative or update on what stage these discussions are presently at?
I'm not sure we have terribly much more to add, other than to perhaps make a point, is that there are a range of views within among stakeholders about the appropriateness of reforms in a report, as well as the important role that advisory groups will play. There are significant representative groups amongst the legal profession about some of the changes, some of the reasons behind some of the changes, and how appropriate these will be. What matters is that all of those voices are heard through detailed, clear consultation arrangements, and particularly those of victims groups that represent people's experiences of the justice system that they are playing into the reforms and innovations that are being proposed.
Yeah. And I'm assuming that obviously all the views and experiences of a wide range of stakeholders are going to be important to mitigating the risks within the system. And the report states that the Scottish Government, the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Services and partners recognise the key risks to reducing the backlog and to achieving longer term and much needed transformation. And the report states that, and I quote, ongoing and effective involvement of a wide range of stakeholders will be important to both mitigate and manage these risks now and into the future. Are you aware of what steps are being undertaken presently to mitigate those risks whilst all these other interventions are taking place?
So we understand that engagement is happening across the different stakeholder groups between the Court Service and the Scottish Government as part of the consideration of the reforms. But that's at a high level, Mr Hoy. Really, in terms of the detail of how those discussions are progressing, the Courts and Tribunal Service is probably better placed to update the committee.
Fine. And just in terms of the three-year plan, if for any reason it didn't come out during the summer, what do you think the risks that would pose to the transformation agenda within the Scottish Prison Service and the Scottish Court Service?
Yes, we make the point in the report that this is a vital component of really the detail of how some of the ambitions and vision for justice will be implemented. We would expect to see both some of the finances set out more clearly, the anticipated longevity of some of innovations and the associated outcomes. The two ought to go hand in hand. So we do reference both the strategy and the delivery plan planned to be published closer together than is currently. So we do have a delay in that. The longer that delay continues, I guess the more challenging will be to set out in a clear, transparent way what the intended outcomes and benefits from the Vision for Justice will be. So we do make the call that should be published urgently.
OK, thanks very much. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, well, thank you. Well, that concludes our questions this morning. So can I once again thank Auditor General, you for your evidence this morning, and also thank Lindsay Davis and Mark Taylor. We will now move the committee into private session. Thank you.